But let's start on the content, okay? Let's start with the first important topic. How is bromate actually being formed? And the question that is important for practitioners is, can we do something about it? So let's look into bromate formation. If you look into bromate formation, I'm pretty sure all of you, if you're a bit familiar with how ozone works, you cannot have bromate without bromide, Br-. The higher your bromide in your water, the more bromate you will have. That's like the rule of thumb. But it's not as simple as that. Huh? So how does it happen? In one way or the other, you have to go from left, from bromide, to bromate. It's not so obvious because there is a lot of chemistry involved. Yeah, don't get confused by this very complex chemistry scheme here. A lot of people in the past have been working on this. But just remember two things. The first one is bromide can either react with hydroxyl radicals. The second one is bromide can also react with ozone. So it's either one of those that makes you will finally end up with bromate. But just pay attention to this route. Okay, just imagine it reacts with hydroxyl radicals. Okay, it forms some intermediates, but you still need ozone along the way. You still need ozone here for the final step as well. So the conclusion here is to have bromate formation occurring, you actually need dissolved ozone residual. So having ozone is even not enough. You need some local dissolved ozone residual. This is also the reason why advanced oxidation processes solely relying on hydroxyl radicals, one example is UV peroxide, don't have bromate formation because you have no ozone to do the final work. So this is important to remember. Two steps in the beginning and then different things happen. It's very complex in real water. But what are the practical implications of that? What are the practical implications? We will now do a small demonstration for you. We will gradually build up this story. So we take everybody and everybody understands. So we will start very simple. We will start at the batch scale. So just imagine you are in the lab. You have some of your water sample, whatever water sample you have, and you pour in some ozone. You pour in an ozone stock solution that has pre-dissolved ozone. So it means you have no gas phase. You have a different system or a different beaker where you bubble through ozone, ozone dissolves, and this is your ozone stock solution. It's all dissolved. For example, 60 milligrams per liter. It's very reasonable. You add a part of that to your beaker and ozone starts reacting. That's a very small, simple experiment I think everybody understands. Now, this is an important thing. What would there be a difference if you add all of your ozone all at once? Just imagine you add 5 milligrams per liter all at once, or you add it in 3 times. So you divide the volume in 3 parts and you add a first volume, you wait like for 20 seconds, you add a second one, you wait for 20 seconds and you add the third one. In the end, you have actually applied exactly the same ozone dose. So here's a small question for you. So let's do a small poll. Here is a poll. Normally, there should be a poll on the screen. Here's the question. Imagine you add everything at once and you have a formation of 13 micrograms per liter. And imagine you do exactly the same experiment, but you add it in 3 times. What is the residual bromate you will be forming? And you can vote actually now. Is it 8 micrograms per liter, 10, 13, or 15? So let's see what the audience thinks. Okay, there is quite some things happening here. It's a live poll. More than half of the people have voted. Yeah, it's very close. So I'll end the polling within like 3 seconds. Give it your final thoughts. I hope the results will appear here on the screen. Yeah, I hope you can see them. But anyway, the winner is 8 micrograms per liter. It's like 47% of you that really believes you will have much less bromate. And then it's like divided. But quite some people, like 25%, 1/4 of the audience also thinks you will have higher bromate. So 15 micrograms per liter. So I will share the results. Normally, you can see the results right now on the screen. So 8 is the winner, but there are quite some people also thinking that you will have higher bromate formation. Okay, well, the best way to illustrate this is to go live to our colleague Giacomo in Italy. Giacomo, you can take over here and you can give the final answer and the demonstration.
Yes, that's let me share my screen. What you see now is the Sumo platform, the platform that we use to implement to embed the Amazon model. What you see here is the representation of the example that Vim just mentioned, a single beaker with some water inside with a certain characteristics in terms of organic matter, of inorganic components, and other constituents and certain pH and so on. So a certain water matrix in a beaker in which we are going to dose a single shot of ozone, 21 milligrams per liter of ozone all at once. Now, what you see here is what actually happened in a batch experiment, and you see the measured data points here and the model fitting through it. Now, for the ozone residuals, and in red, you see the bromate formed. So it starts at zero, and then it builds up little by little, very suddenly, and it ends up to an end concentration of 13 micrograms per liter. So if we run this, then you can also see it run live. It is a very high resolution simulation. It's 0.1 seconds of data interval for a bit more than 5 minutes. And then you can see the ozone profiles dropping very fast in the initial stage. Why? Because the ozone dose reacts very fast with the organics and the water matrix. And then when the fast reacting part is finished, then it starts reacting with the harder part to be degraded of the organics and also with the inorganic matrix, and then it starts decaying in time. At the same time, you have the production of radicals and ozone at the same time in high concentration presence. This will give the first very rapid jump in bromate, and then it increases also quite fast in the second part, where the radicals concentration, which we can check here. So the radicals are what you can see here. It's that in a matter of milliseconds they are disappearing, but they are depleted very fast because they are fast reacting. And here what happens is the bromate formation of the lower part of the reaction scheme that Vim showed before takes more importance, and until we reach an end concentration. Now, what happens if we divide then this dose in three doses is that we start with the original water that we took at the beginning. So no ozone is added at this time. And we are going to give a first shot of 7 milligrams per liter of ozone. Now, what happens is that if we take out the original measurements for the single dose, then we see that the 7 milligrams of ozone per liter, they are very fast depleted because it's a small concentration, and the fast reacting part of the organics and the water matrix reacts very fast with the ozone, and it depletes the ozone in terms of few seconds. And then 0.8 micrograms of bromate are formed. But now what happens if we give a second shot is that the initial depletion of ozone is slightly lower because there is less of the fast reacting components in the water matrix. And then the lifetime of ozone, it's a bit longer, and there might be more bromate formation in the in the second part of the reaction, which leads to 2.4 in total of bromide form. Then if we, on top of this, reach a total dose of 21 with the third dose of 7 milligrams per liter, then we can see the bromide increasing, and who's the winner? As those ones that actually the majority, or if I remember well, almost the majority voted for 8 micrograms per liter. So congrats. That's what happens. That splitting the dose in three small doses, so having the overall dose the same as the single dose, helps in controlling bromide formation. Why this is happening? For a complex net of reasons, which is the link to the complex net of reactions that lead to bromide formation. In a nutshell, you leave more chances to the reactions that take away the BR formed in the middle of the way of going to bromate to the final bromate formation to be dragged back. You also improve a little bit more the scavenging of the radicals. On the other hand, you might lose some, but a very negligible part of the potential for micropollutants residual. Here, what you see is the removal of some of the micropollutants that we have here. It's just some examples. They are depleted as in a comparable extent to the single dose. So the message is the micropollutants do not, the removal do not change significantly, but the bromate formation, it can be controlled very in a very important way.